has probably been doing comedy as long as every comic that has performed tonight. That's a fantastic fact. For over 25 years, this man has been making the Bay Area his home, his playground, his stomping grounds, everything you can think of when it comes to becoming the comedian he is today. And tonight, we bring forward for the very first time in this room, the one and only, this is a great stage name, because who knows what it leads to. This is Johnny Corn. That's right, everybody. You thought Halloween was over. Johnny Corn. Thank you, TJ. Welcome. Hi, Fresno. My name is Johnny Corn. I was actually over at Columbus a little bit. You guys are from Columbus, right? I saw this kid on a leash. And all I can think to myself is that I prefer my kids to be free range. No, because then they taste better. Put an apple in their mouth, put them on a rotisserie spin. Tastes just like chicken. Did I make you wrong? I'm stunned. Okay. So I don't have any biological kids of my own, but they were delicious. So I'm never gonna have kids at this point in my life, I'm gonna take the birth, you know? See, that way my kids come up to me and they say, Daddy, where do babies come from? Oh, yeah. I can go better than that. Let me show you where you came from. No, I'm saying, if I did this, I'd be guaranteed not to become a premature grandfather, right? But for good measure, I think my firstborn daughter, chlamydia. Well, is it the friendly sounding of the STDs? It sounds exotic. And I can't believe that I've been saved. And I can guarantee no guy's going to come in until she's 40. No, but if I were to have kids, what I'd like to do is I'd like to have a talk with them at age 20 about everything that can happen to the body by age 50. Now, some of you guys probably, well, some of you are definitely too young to remember this, but it's coming. It's coming. Just because I like to see the expression on the face, you know? Like, for example, you're going to lose hair where you want hair, and you're going to get hair in other places. When you're done peeing, you're not done peeing. You're going to have to be on medication where a fatal event is one of the side effects. Even the exams get more evasive, you know? For example, the prostate exam. Well, the thing about the prostate exam is I get confused by the etiquette. Let me explain. When you get the prostate exam, do you tip afterwards? If you really like it, you can get on a bi-monthly basis. Yeah. And if you get on a bi-monthly basis, does that mean that TeaZers is a full-service HMO? These are questions that need to be answered. That's what I'm saying, you know? But this is true, too. Injuries at age 20 and age 50, even if it's the same injury, the story behind the injury is completely different. Age 20, dude, I tore my ACL when I slid into third base trying to avoid the tag. Great story, right? Slightly different at age 50. Yeah, I tore my ACL by standing up. No, that's the entire story. I just stood up. You know, it doesn't exactly have the same thing going for it. But what I did actually tell you guys before is true. I don't have any biological kids of my own. I did inherit two kids, 3 years ago, when my mom passed away. And I was doing a show in Scotland, and I brought them with me. And we were in the back seat of the car, right? And we were singing, wheels of the bus go rampant round all through the town. The terrace on the bus has 40 rounds. 40 rounds. The terrace on the bus has 40 rounds. And 108. If you think that's inappropriate, I also give
taking advice. For example, if you hear voices in your head that are telling you to kill, make them cartoon voices so you don't take them seriously. And don't become a homicidal maniac because it's too much work. Let me explain. Because what happens is you go in and first you have to kill the person. And you have to do that successfully or the rest of the steps don't make any sense, right? Yeah. So that has to be, that's paramount. That has to happen. Okay. So that's the first thing. And then you have to chop off the, well actually what you have to do is you have to get rid of the body, but you can grind it into 3 bolts like a needle, which means you can't really do it. So you have to chop them into little pieces to put them into the car and put them right up to the brake side, dig the grave, put the person in the grave, and then you gotta cover the grave, then you gotta clean the crime scene, you gotta clean the car, you gotta remove the murder weapon. If you can do all of that, that's not a thing, man. If you can do that, I'm gonna put them to work as something I want.
You know,
I'll wait. It's okay. I'll ask you that. I'll get you back. A little bit more about me. Am I actually Catholic? As a good Catholic, they tell you have to give up something to Lent. So this year I gave up my New Year's resolution. And at work, you know, I have a day job too, because, you know, comics, you know, this is why we have a tip jar, because comics, we make less than minimum wage for the most part. If you see this guy in the street, says, you know, we'll just stand up for food. That's us. So, but this is true. There was a person that, it was a brain fart here, I can't remember what I was going to say, but there was this thing where it's a multicultural ethnic day is what it was, and you bring in food from school, you bring in food from your culture, okay, so one person brought in kimchi, another person brought in curry and naan, I brought in a box of Lucky Charms. Grew up in an evangelical Christian neighborhood, and they would say stuff like, you go into hell because you haven't accepted Jesus Christ as your personal savior. And they say this to like Jewish friends of mine. That confuses me, because if you really want someone to convert over to Christianity, don't tell them to go into hell. Tell them they can eat bacon. Because bacon gets out of the way, right? Bacon has tomato, bacon and eggs, bacon burger, 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon. What I'm saying is way too much hard for this new stomach. So I have that particular religion, right? Yeah. But I'm a typical Catholic in that I go to church on Christmas and Easter. And when I'm listening to the gospel or to the book, then I try to convert it over to something that takes place today. You know, like, what would it be like if it took place today, you know? So they have, for example, this story about the rabbis of Jesus getting separated by Pontius Pilate, and he's going to let the crowd decide, you see? That was 2,000 years ago, but if it took place today, it'd be the form of reality show. And it would go something like this. I'm Pontius Pilate, and thus welcome to Crucifixion. It's the show where you, the people, get to decide who gets to live and who gets to die. Let's meet our contestants. First, we have Barabbas Nefarious. One person like that. Up against Jesus H. Christ. Now, the H stands for Hubert. That's a little trivia for you. That's his real name. So, if you want Barabbas to live, then text. 666. And if you want Jesus to die, not that the officials are fixed, but if you want Jesus to die, text 999 and hold your phone upside down. Phone rings will always have the results. That's interesting since the phone rings are open. Okay. Well, the person that's going to be set free is what to be revealed right after this work. And then they have a totally inappropriate ad like, do you have that? Not so fresh feeling. And now, crucifixion. Okay, so the person is going to be set free, perhaps Jesus, and have results in the... how do you meet each other? Perhaps Jesus, perhaps. Okay. The person that's going to be set free is perhaps, but Jesus, you get a consolation prize. This week is death. But you get one last song, okay? So we're going to bring in the apostles and the rabbis. I'm just going to do a little bit of temptations, right? We're going to be rabbis, and we're going to come in. Now, I doubt Thomas will be there, and Judas is hanging outside, but we're going to bring the apostles. Anyway, I'm Pontius Pilate, reminding you, I'm not going to, before I wash my hands this whole thing, I just got to tell you, I'm not going to be next week. Filling in for me will be Ryan Seacrest. And Jesus is going like, I really don't like this show. What the? Anyway, so that am I the one that thinks like that? I got people saying, yeah, okay, well. But the thing is, as Catholic, you know, you have this stuff like, for example, holidays, you know, they had Columbus Day, was a big holiday for Catholics, you know, and it became bigger as I got older, you know. And the thing about Columbus Day, I don't understand it. He gets a holiday for getting lost. No, he was trying to find a spice route to India, ended up in the Caribbean, which last time I checked was kind of like in the other direction. But he told the man, didn't ask directions. I mean, after all he had to do is to go to any 7-Eleven, and they could have told him or any of us. I'm just saying. Yeah. And the Thanksgiving's this month, right? The story behind Thanksgiving is that white people were freezing and cold and hungry, and the Indians took pity on them, so they broke bread at the table and they fed them. Great story, right? The second Thanksgiving is a story where the Indian people were really, really cold, and we gave them blankets.
Yeah.
Little small pots right there. Moving on to Christmas. Now, the thing about Christmas is it confuses me a little bit because, like, I find it to be a little bit weird because you tell your kids all year long, don't talk to strangers, and then sit them on a stranger's lap. And who else can get away with saying this any other time of the year except for Christmas? Santa, little girl. Tell Santa what you really want. Have you been naughty? You want to be my nice list? Are you a ho-ho-ho? You want to put your hand in your stocking? Just kind of a little bit creepy. You know? Just like that. And in New Year's. New Year's is another one. Okay, so New Year's. It's an odometer. Right? You're basically celebrating what amounts to an odometer. That number goes from the last digit, the very last digit goes from a 4 to a 5. It goes up 1. And then it goes 4. Five. Ah! Okay, drink. Yeah. You know, that just to me is kind of. Okay, that's all fine. But that's okay. Yeah. I actually have been doing a lot of traveling around, and the thing that I find interesting is people say, you're from San Jose, you're from one of the safest cities. And whenever someone says that to me, I say two words. King and story. And for those of you who don't know, there's a few people nodding, for the rest of you, that's not exactly the best neighborhood. I'm just saying. There's still those sites that are not a good neighborhood, so I'm going to share this with you just so if you ever get caught in a bad neighborhood, you know what's going on. You know you're in a bad neighborhood when you get pulled over for being white. When you see a really big guy on a really tiny bicycle. When you see a sofa on their front porch. Barbecuing in the front yard, you know. I still can't believe this is true, but there, down the street, there was a guy that had a pickup truck, this is true, had a pickup truck, the AstroTurf, and then the truck, drilled a hole and went to golf in the truck. But not to me, I've done it, the guy next door to me, immediately next door to me, had an old round truck, and he converted the bed of the truck into a swimming pool. It's a little bit ghetto, right? You know? But I, as was introduced at the beginning, I've been doing comedy now for 27 years. Anniversary was on October 25th. Yeah, so 27 years on October 25th, so just passed. The very first time I went on stage, President Reagan was still president at the time, and I did President Reagan as a pervert. I'll never forget this. This is a little story, because I feel like I know you guys haven't done your business. So I go on stage and go like, oh, Nancy, come here and let's do that ass. Come and hug it. In 1999, 2000, somewhere around there, I came up with some new jokes about the phone with the camera in it, because we didn't have social media yet, so I didn't understand the camera and the phone together. That didn't make any sense to me. It's like two separate appliances together. And so I was wondering what didn't make it past the focus groups. And, for example, I'm personally glad that the lockdown phone didn't make it past. And you know what? The shotgun phone didn't make it past the focus groups. And the focus groups kind of thinned out a little bit. The best protection against identity theft is bad credit. I'm Johnny Korn, thank you, and have a